Right now, a surge of hot air is engulfing most of the U.S., but a strange, backwards-moving cold front is about to bring around some major changes, especially in the Northeast. Not only that, but it's only June 2nd, and we already have important tropical weather to start digging into. Something's rapidly developed in the Gulf of Mexico that you should know more about. In addition to that, the 10th, 20th round of severe weather is in place for the High Plains later today, and it's looking like it's going to be quite vigorous. And on top of that, I have some bad news concerning drought for much of the Midwestern U.S. here. So all of that and more, let's dive right into it. The air is slowly but surely clearing out over here in the Northeastern U.S. after several days of poor air quality has persisted due to wildfires in Nova Scotia. At the surface, high pressure has been in place for a while in this area, which was locking in place both hot, stagnant air and the resulting wildfire smoke. That's also prevented any moisture from reaching into this area, meaning that it's remained bone dry out there. On top of the stagnant air, that's a recipe for disaster, unfortunately. Yesterday, parts of northern Maine and Quebec made it to 95 degrees Fahrenheit, or about 35 Celsius, up in this area. That's how ridiculous this pattern has been for our friends up there in northern New England, Quebec, and also New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. So looking at the near-surface smoke here, that surface high pressure should skedaddle, and the air quality should improve over the next few days for the northeastern U.S. However, the wildfires there in Nova Scotia are still burning and will continue to do so for a few more days. Let's be thinking of our friends over there in Halifax and any surrounding areas, as many people have been evacuated due to wildfires there. On top of that, we have an ongoing drought in the central U.S. and a developing drought here in the Midwest. Notice the extreme and exceptional drought here in the central, while the Midwest is currently just abnormally dry on the lower end of the scale here, with localized areas of moderate drought seen here. These conditions are likely to change in June, though. Looking closely here, the current pattern has been pumping severe storms over the high plains over and over, bringing plenty of rain, so this area is going to continue to receive rainfall over the next couple weeks or so, which will improve the drought conditions as you see in this map, as thirsty crops get their long-awaited rainfall. On the other hand, that same pattern that's delivering rain to the high plains is expected to continue to develop and worsen the drought here in the Midwest in areas in yellow. This is the area of drought development and even rapid onset drought from the Climate Prediction Center. And this is because of this massive ridge over the center of North America. Under these ridges, there's sinking air, which means no rainfall. So there's that ridge drawn right there in those red and yellow showing up. And underneath this ridge, as it sits there and spins constantly over the next few days, over the next week even, there's what's called compressional warming, meaning all this air is sinking down to the surface. And as it sinks, it gets compressed under high pressure. And when it gets compressed, it heats up. Those are the ingredients that we oftentimes see for heat and drought. There's actually something very interesting about this heat dome in particular. You may have caught it if you look closely at that last loop. So the observer and I may notice that in general, much of our weather flows from west to east, because atmospheric waves generally move west to east in the areas we're usually focused on, the US and southern Canada. Well, this wave is going to do something called retrograding, in which it will actually move from east to west. This happens if the wave is particularly long with ample north-to-south flow. It has the chance to get stuck in place or even move west, as you can see, following that area of red and pink. So going backwards in time there, and now going forwards in time, watch it move to the west. A pattern like this allows the rotation of the Earth to actually have a larger effect on this wave's movement rather than the jet stream itself. And because of that, it means that the ridge is going to be over this area for a long period of time, which is going to enhance the drought in the Midwest and continue the rains there in the high plains. So if you live in the Northeast, you've probably noticed the incredibly high temperatures over the past couple of days here. A huge surge of warmth has been bringing temperatures up to 30 degrees above historical averages across much of the eastern U.S. Here you can see that in red and brown. That's about to change for y'all, though. And it's actually because of that retrograding feature that I just mentioned. So going back to our loop here of the ridge, on the eastern edge of that big dome of high pressure, you can see something develop here. There's a weak point right here. This is a sneaky area of low pressure that's trying to wedge its way into southeastern Canada and down into New England. So a lot of you in this area are familiar with the term backdoor cold front, and that's exactly exactly what's going to happen here. So for those unfamiliar, essentially this low pressure system is going to bring in colder air from east, northeast Canada back down the Atlantic coast. That cold air is going to travel south and west with time, as you can see here on this map, which is, you know, opposite the direction that we're typically used to seeing. And that's going to happen into the middle of the week. Eventually, it stops when it meets up with the Appalachian Mountains here and that dome of hot air over the central U.S., as it doesn't really have a driving force to push it further west. It's mostly just stalled over the northeast. But, referring to earlier in the wildfires in Nova Scotia, the good news is that this backdoor cold front should hopefully bring much milder temperatures and maybe some chances for rain, scattered showers through the middle of the week here. That was the eastern half of the Big Ridge. Now let's focus on what's going to happen on the western edge of it, because we have weather impacts on both sides and in between. So over here on the western side, we have our continued risk for excessive rainfall with two areas of a moderate risk today from the Weather Prediction Center, focused here in West Texas and also in Montana, extending up into Saskatchewan. Some of these areas are already very hard hit, especially here in the panhandle of Texas and West Texas, that have received so much rainfall recently, with a bunch of rain destroying cattle farms and making plenty of roads impassable. I was just there and I saw a lot of impassable roads due to flooding when I was out there storm chasing. So more rainfall for these guys, not exactly the best thing, even though it is a drought buster. Today also carries an enhanced risk, or 3 out of 5, for severe weather for these areas in orange, including Lubbock, Midland, Odessa, and San Angelo here in Texas. So the hours of concern for the severe weather risk are going to be early in the afternoon through the evening and done by midnight. The tornado threat is expected to stay on the slight side here in the brown for Lubbock and Midland, Odessa, where the exact right sequence of events would be needed to cause a tornado in these areas. That is to say, it's unlikely, but we'll probably see some tornado warnings in here somewhere, meaning that the chance is there for one to develop, and you definitely should be taking shelter if that happens. From the Storm Prediction Center's hail outlook, we can see that the risk starts up immediately. We have a dry line right about here that I'm going to show you in a little bit, and once that dry line fires off supercells, immediately we get very large to giant hail possible, especially in this area of red and the hatched risk area here. Then, a little further along into the evening, this hail risk transitions to a damaging wind threat as well. As we get a little further east here, supercells are going to congeal together into a line of storms and pose a higher-end damaging wind threat as they approach San Angelo. So, let's look at some ingredients here for severe weather. Here's our surface dew points for the entire U.S., or how much moisture exists outside. Over here, it's going to feel the same way as it has for the last couple of weeks. So what makes today any different or more vigorous for severe weather for our friends in Lubbock and Midland and Odessa? Well, if we look at model data, we can see this sneaky area of blue here that's showing up today behind the risk areas that are highlighted right here in West Texas. So this is our shortwave, or a smaller low pressure system that's sneaking in through the southwest states and providing a bunch of lift out here for storms to develop. So which of these storms are going to be supercells? Let's take a look looking at our bulk wind direction, or really just the average wind direction from here at the surface to maybe about 4 or 5 miles above our heads. Which way is the wind blowing on average? What this tells us is if storms are going to form and run into each other a bunch, or if they're going to form and remain on their own track for a while, undisturbed for the most part. So reading the wind barbs up here towards Amarillo, they're mostly going to the northeast here, and our storms are expected to form off a boundary that looks like this. So when these storms form, they're going to run into each other just like this, and they're going to become a line very quickly to the north of Lubbock. But down here, our winds are pointed in this direction for Midland, Odessa, and San Angelo. This means if we get a supercell in these regions here, they're actually going to remain discrete, meaning that we have a longer period of time where we could get very large hail, also chances at tornadoes down here that are not rain-wrapped. And the colors simply mean the strength or the speed of these winds. So for the most part, through this area that's highlighted from the Storm Prediction Center, we can see these purples and pinks. Those are winds that are strong enough to create supercells. And that's why we have this enhanced risk area from the Storm Prediction Center due to those ingredients. So stay weather aware here in West Texas for yet another day. Now let's focus our attention to the West Coast, where May gray has turned into June gloom for some parts of California. You can start to get an idea of what might happen looking at this expected temperature map from the Climate Prediction Center, where below this line we have a bunch of colder temperatures than average expected, and above it we have what could be another heat wave for the Pacific Northwest, west into Alberta and British Columbia. So what usually happens in between two different air masses like this? If you guessed rain, you're correct. Take a look at this rainfall outlook for about a week from now from the Climate Prediction Center as well. Quite the rare June precipitation pattern here in parts of Nevada, Intermountain West through Salt Lake City, and also California and the Sierras. So this is a very high confidence and above average rainfall for these areas in June. I feel like that's a little wild for these parts. So let's take a look at why this is happening. As we get to the end of the weekend, you can see this feature sneaking in the left side of your screen right there. There he is, right there. That's an upper level low. So a miniature trough there, and it's approaching the Southern California coastline. So out to the north of this thing, it's going to focus winds from the south like this. And right in this region, we're going to have something called upper level divergence, which is where the winds are parting ways and we need air to rise to fill that space. That's all thanks to that low pressure system that's sneaking towards Southern California. And all the ingredients needed to bring thunderstorm potential here are in place from the Sierras to southern portions of Oregon and east through southern Idaho, Nevada, and Utah. So this guy's not going to go anywhere very fast here. So that means that rain chances are going to continue for quite some time in these regions as the same ingredients are in place. Thus, by next weekend, the Sierras could see anywhere from an inch to an inch and a half of rain after this is said and done. On top of snowmelt, this could create flooding hazards. And this is in June! I still can't get over that as a native Californian. So similar to the severe weather coverage that I've started up on this channel, it's now finally time to talk about tropical severe weather. As of yesterday, it's officially the start of the hurricane season in the North Atlantic Basin. So the North Atlantic Ocean, which impacts much of us in the US and Eastern Canada. And already we've got a steamy Gulf of Mexico here in the reds and oranges. These are temperatures of about 82 degrees Fahrenheit. And sure enough, right in these waters, one customer is already taking up his vacation time and setting up early here in that hot spring-like water. Nothing like a jacuzzi. A cluster of thunderstorms has been milling about just off the coast of Florida and Alabama down here in this area of blue and white. We can see this on satellite water vapor imagery. So these are all the storms associated with that system. And generally around this area of storms, we can see that the flow is kind of just meandering and very weak. This is supportive for a tropical storm to develop. So previously from the National Hurricane Center, who have started putting out their outlooks, it was only given about a 10 to a 20% chance of development over the next few days. And that was before it would meet a hostile environment. But over the last couple days, it has managed to string quickly together a complete circle of rotating winds, demarking it as a tropical depression just barely below tropical storm status. So I've actually already had a few curious viewers ask me why this storm is moving south, which may seem like an abnormal direction. So to answer that, we go right back to this, which you've seen three times already, the big ridge in the central states and Canada. So much like that backdoor cold front that's going to develop over here moving south and west, around the ridge, winds are also blowing to the south from the north here. So winds are generally traveling around the ridge like this. And if you watch it develop over the next couple of days, you can see these lines begin to establish themselves, and we could follow them all the way down here towards our tropical depression that's sitting right off the coast of Florida. So it's these winds from this ridge all the way up here that are actually steering that little tropical depression all the way down to Florida. And if we look closer here at the Caribbean, we can see this tropical low develop and move into an area that has a bit faster of winds aloft here as these lines become closer together. So this tells me that the winds are moving faster down here near Cuba, and that's going to tear this tropical low apart before it can really establish itself or become Arlene, our first storm name. Thus, to boot up our tropical season is a system that won't bring any direct impacts to land besides some spare precipitation here to western Cuba. Any rain in the southeastern states here that you experience is not going to be closely tied to that system. Meanwhile, across the Pacific Basin, Mawar has been churning up some impressive statistics in the western Pacific Ocean during my time away storm chasing. Over a week after impacting Guam and the Mariana Islands here as a Category 4 super typhoon in the Pacific Ocean, now tropical storm Mawar has both weakened significantly and made a hard right turn into the Philippine Sea and past Japan. Now south of Japan, with maximum wind speeds of about 50 miles an hour, Mawar is not expected to make any further impacts on any significant land masses here, nor is it expected to intensify. So we've finally seen the last of Typhoon Mawar as it fizzles apart later this week. At its peak, Tropical Storm Mawar was a super typhoon with maximum recorded wind speeds of 298 kilometers per hour or 185 miles per hour, solidifying it in the top percent percentage and most powerful tropical storms around the globe. Despite reaching that intensity after passing through Guam and the Mariana Islands, serious damage was sustained by the island of Guam, where since then only 28% of residents have had their power restored, and even less have clean water or internet access, of course. So let's be thinking about our friends over there in Guam as well. So hopefully this video helped bridge the gap while I was out storm chasing. Apologies for that. I was out there for 2 weeks, mostly in the high plains with an Airbnb in Oklahoma City. So pay attention to posts on this channel if you don't use Twitter. I'll be sharing some of the captures I had here during my chase vacation or chasecation, as well as some of the cool people I met, like Dr. Reed Timmer, Pico's Hank, Daniel Shaw, and more. Now, typically, I prefer to remain modest about subscriptions to YouTube channels and so forth, but the duality of severe weather into June, while we also have our tropical weather season starting up, that urges me to say that staying tuned to this channel and all that we do in the Y'all Squad is of utmost importance now. So, please make sure you subscribe and turn on notifications so you don't miss a video about any important updates, whether if it's for you or for somebody you care about, or just people in general, or you just want to learn. Hopefully my updates will help with all of those categories as much as possible. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.